Hello， 各位小伙伴们，大家好。本期呢又到了跟大家分享《经济学人》杂志最新一期的时间了。我们先来简单的看一下今天杂志有哪些主要内容，后面呢我会挑选一篇文章进行一个精读。封面最上面的文章呢是 Myanmar on the brink of collapse， 那说呢就是缅甸呢已经濒临了这个崩溃的边缘哈。America's inflation spike， 美国的通胀飙升，然后 United Kingdom the perilous state of the union。那翻译呢我跟大家说明一下，是我使用 Traddles 翻译软件的 It doesn't make sense at all 是吧，来直接使用谷歌机器翻译将经济学人的英文版本全文翻译成中文的版本，让你能够实时的进行这种中英文的对照，这样让你在学习的这个阅读的过程中呢让你速度更快，节约大量的时间。今天给大家精读的文章是在 Books and Arts 这个区域。 OK let's get to it。 A very close shave the Cold War，这里呢 a very close shave 的意思呢应该是一个侥幸。 a very close shave 意思就是说1962年秋天发生的这个古巴导弹危机呢，当时呢是没有演变成核灾难，是一个非常侥幸的事情。 A definitive new account of the Cuban Missile Crisis sounds a warning， 关于古巴导弹危机的新定论呢给我们提出了一个警醒。 On October 27th 1962 at the height of the Cuban Missile CrisisIt was only the purest luck that saved the world from nuclear catastrophe. 1962年10月27号呢，在这个古巴导弹危机的最高峰呢，这个世界之所以被拯救呢，完全是因为运气啊。
Hello， 大家好，我是 Bruce。提醒一下大家，一定要一键三连哦！你们的点赞、关注、评论是我继续做原创英语视频的最大动力。
Five days earlier, President John Kennedy had announced a naval blockade of the island to force his opposite number in the Kremlin.Nikita Khrushchev to withdraw the medium-range nuclear missiles he had sent to Cuba in the summer of that year. 五天以前呢，肯尼迪总统呢宣布对古巴进行军事封锁，海上封锁。这个封锁的目的呢是迫使他的对手，也就是克里姆林宫的尼皮塔赫鲁晓夫，就是苏联的赫鲁晓夫，把他的中程弹道导弹呢，中程核导弹呢，从古巴呢。withdraw 就是撤回，然后这些导弹呢是在1962年的夏天 summer of that year 被送到古巴的。 US Navy anti-submarine warfare patrols were hunting down Soviet nuclear-armed subs that posed a threat to the blockade. 美国的海军反潜艇巡逻队呢正在追捕对封锁对这种海上封锁构成威胁的苏联核武潜艇。The plan was to pressure the submarines into leaving the area of operation by dropping practice depth charges and grenades. 计划呢是通过投放呢深水炸弹 pressure 可以做一般做名词 pressure 表示压力，然后也可以做动词表示迫使的意思。通过投放深水炸弹的方式让苏联的这种核潜艇离开它的作战区域。But not to destroy them unless absolutely necessary. 但是呢在不必要的情况下呢又不要去摧毁它们，就以免酿成事态的扩大。Submarine B-59 had experienced the effects of that pressure for 2 days and its crew were growing desperate from intense heat and toxic levels of carbon dioxide. 就是苏联的 B-59 号核潜艇呢就已经在这种高压的情况下呢就是持续运行了2天，他们的船员绝望地忍受着。When it surfaced for air, B-59 found itself harassed by American planes firing chaser bullets and flares. 当 B-59 浮出水面呢发现呢他们遭到了美国人的骚扰。怎样骚扰呢？发射带有示踪剂的子弹和炸弹 chaser bullets and flares. Flares 实际上是一种信号弹。一般是一种发光的闪光信号弹，然后发射出去呢，然后我们的友军呢就能够看到这个敌方的潜艇的位置，从而进行精确的攻击。Convinced that his ship was under attack and that war had broken out, the sub's captain Valentin Savsky gave the order to dive and prepare to launch a nuclear-armed torpedo. 那这个苏联潜艇的上尉瓦伦丁·萨维斯基呢，他坚信呢 ，convinced。就是他们已经被攻击了，就是美国人坚信呢，美国人已经开动了战争，发动了战争。于是呢，就准备下令，潜艇下潜，并准备发射带有核武器的这个鱼雷 torpedo, nuclear armed torpedo, with 10 kilotons of explosive power, it would produce massive waves and sink or incapacitate any nearby American warships.
那带有十千吨呢？就是十千吨 kiloton 是千吨哈 ，ton 才是吨。所以说呢，这里翻译成十吨实际上是不准确的。Ten kilotons of explosive power 带有一万吨的这种爆炸力的这种核武器的鱼雷呢，它能够产生 massive waves。能够产生巨大的这种浪波浪，然后呢沉没或者使附近的所有的美国军舰呢都瘫痪，直接瘫痪。
Two things stopped the order from being carried out.
有两件事呢阻止了这个命令被执行。那我们也是非常幸运是吧，要是被执行的话可能 美苏就开始战争，然后我们就完蛋了。
The commander of one of the American destroyers, the Coney, realized what was about to happen and flashed an apology for the aggressive behavior of the planes.
那是美国人呢也比较的克制比较明智啊，反应的非常快，于是呢他赶紧下令啊，就 flashed an apology for the aggressive behavior, 就是用就是一个 flash 就是一种闪光嘛，闪光弹应该是用闪光弹来发送一个道歉的信号，应该是说军舰在跟敌方的军舰沟通这么一种方式啊。
Had the sub's signals officer not got stuck with his searchlight in the shaft of the conning tower,
本来苏联这一方的这个信号官呢是看不到这个美方发射出来这种道歉信号的，但是呢由于这个信号官当时呢被出现一个小意外被卡在了这个指挥塔这个信号这个探照灯上面，因为出现了一个问题，具体什么问题我也不知道是吧，然后呢
That gave the commander of the submarine task force, Vasily Akipov, who was behind him, the chance to countermand the order.
于是呢，因为这个信号官刚好看见了这个美国的道歉信号，于是呢，这就给这个潜艇的，潜艇的特遣部队指挥官啊，瓦西里·阿尔西波夫提供了一个一个撤销命令的一个机会。应该是 countermand 就是撤销， command 是指下令， countermand 就是一个反过来的意思，撤销命令。
If the nuclear torpedo had been fired, Kennedy would have had little choice other than to order a strike against Soviet targets with the inevitable consequence of escalatory retaliation.
那如果当时和这个核鱼雷呢被发射出去呢，肯尼迪呢几乎没有其他的一个办法除了去下令报复是吧，对苏联的这种目标实行打击然后导致呢这种扩大化的报复性行动，不仅是苏联的这种报复性行动，也可能是美国的报复性行动，这样双方的战争就会升级。那幸亏呢有了这么一个信号被看到，所以呢就没有发生这个灾难性的后果。
A few hours earlier, ignoring orders from Moscow, a Soviet surface-to-air missile battery had shot down an American U-2 spy plane over Cuba.
在几个小时以前呢，苏联方呢无视这个莫斯科的命令已经击落了一个美国的 U-2 间谍飞机这个飞机呢飞到古巴那边去，然后就被苏联呢击落了。
Soviet forces on the island were jumpy, fearing that an invasion was imminent.
那这个时候呢苏联的军事力量，那苏联部队呢，那这个时候在古巴的军事，那这个时候在古巴的苏联部队呢就心里就焦虑不安jumpy 不是急速，显然是说焦虑不安 jumpy,
fearing that an invasion was imminent,
就是害怕呢即将接受入侵，被入侵 imminent 就是即将发生。
The leaders on both sides were fast losing their grip on what was happening on the ground,
双方的领导人呢都在迅速的对地面的发生的事情呢局势呢失去掌控。
The next day, an increasingly alarmed Khrushchev announced that he was taking his missiles out of Cuba. In return, he had received the commitment from Kennedy that America would abandon any idea of invading and deposing the country's revolutionary Marxist leader, Fidel Castro.
那第二天，越来越震惊的克鲁晓夫呢，宣布他将把古巴送到古巴的导弹呢，从古巴撤出。那作为回报呢 ，in return。他得到了肯尼迪总统的承诺 commitment, 就是说美国呢会放弃任何入侵和推翻罢免这个古巴的马克思主义领导人菲德尔·卡斯特罗的一个承诺。
There were some tricky moments still to come, but the world breathed a collective sigh of relief.
那后面仍然有一些棘手的时刻出现 啊，糟糕的时刻出现，但是呢，世界呢整体来说是松了一口气。It has become conventional wisdom that disaster was never all that close because both Kennedy and Khrushchev were equally fearful of the nuclear Armageddon that their actions could trigger. 就是有传统上的都认为 conventional wisdom 就是大家一般都认为呢，就是核灾难呢不会那么容易发生，因为呢肯尼迪和赫鲁晓夫都同样害怕这种核毁灭，核大决战 Armageddon 就是一个大决战，是从圣经里面来的。 Nuclear folly Sahih Plocky's new history of the Cuban Missile Crisis not only casts fresh light on what happened that autumn but strips away any such comfort. 那这个作者的新书创造了一个词汇叫做 Nuclear folly， 就是核愚蠢，不仅给当年秋天发生的事情呢提供了新的亮点， cast fresh light on something， 而且消除了 strips away any such comfort， 就消除了这种舒适的讨论这个问题的这种情景，就是说不要去认为这么轻松的去认为当时的古巴这种导弹危机可以轻松的避免，其实呢它实际上是我们能够避免，其实是一个真的是一个非常侥幸的一个几率。 It is a story of intelligence failures, misperceptions and miscalculations on both sides that had the potential at almost every step to lead to a disaster. 这是一个关于情报错误呢双方错误认识和错误估算的一个故事，几乎在每一个步骤中都有可能导致灾难性的后果。 The American side of the story is relatively familiar from previous accounts of the crisis. 美国方面的这个情况呢基本上相对来说比较熟悉，因为有很多这种关于危机的一个描述。 Accounts of 就是 description. What makes this the definitive story? What makes this the definitive history is Mr. Plocky's telling of the tale in gripping detail from the Soviet perspective. 那让这个故事呢成为一个被确认的历史呢，就是 Plocky 先生呢对这个故事呢这种生动的一个讲述， gripping detail 对这个细节生动的讲述， gripping 就是一个抓住能够抓动人心的细节的一个非常生动的一个讲述。他从那个苏联方面去讲述，所以说因为以前的这些书啊作品啊都是从美国方面的讲述，所以说这提供了一个新的一个观点。 A professor of history at Harvard who made his name with a prize winning book about the Chernobyl disaster, Mr. Plocky realized that the UkrainianRevolution of 2014 could lead to an opening up of former KGB archives. 作为一个哈佛大学历史学教授，并且有一本成名之作，什么成名之作呢？关于切尔诺贝利这种核灾难的一个成名之作，这本书是他写的。Mr. Plocky 先生呢，也意识到呢，苏克兰2014年的乌克兰革命呢，会导致可能开放，可能将以前的这个苏联的 KGB 克格勃的这种档案进行一个开放。 Nearly all the missiles dispatched to Cuba came from Ukraine, while every ship transporting them and the 40,000 Russian military personnel needed to build, man and defend the launch sites carried a KGB officer who filed meticulous reports. 几乎所有的被送到古巴的导弹 dispatch 送往都来自乌克兰生产的，同时呢每一辆运输这个四万名俄罗斯军事人员，什么样的军事人员呢？去建造、动员和保卫这些发射场所所需要的四万名俄罗斯军事人员呢，都随身带着一个 KGB officer 克格勃的军官。那这个克格勃的军官呢，会在事后呢去撰写发送这个非常详尽的关于这些事件的报告。所以说，如果开放这些克格勃的档案呢，就能够让我们后人呢了解其中的详情。Mr. Plocky vividly describes the lengths that Soviet went to in their effort to keep the mission secret. Men and missiles were kept between decks away from prying American eyes for the duration of the voyage. Plocky 先生呢，生动地描述了苏联为保守这些任务秘密而竭尽全力的努力。The crews encountered difficulties working in unfamiliar tropical waters. 船员们呢，也因为在这个陌生的热带水域工作呢，航行呢就遇到一系列的这个生活上的困难，不适应啊等等。Commanders on the ground were convinced they would have to repel an American invasion at any moment. 那地面指挥官呢也深信，他们必须随时做好击退美国人入侵的一个准备，战斗准备。Repel 就是击退。Prepared for combat, they felt deep humiliation when ordered to pack up and go home. 因为他们已经做好了战斗准备，所以后面在古巴导弹危机解除之后，他们被告知要回家呀，就是收拾行李 pack up 打包是吧，非常形象，然后回家呢，所以他们觉得自己就是已经非常屈辱，作为一个军人嘛，本来说有仗打，大家都做好了准备是吧，我这裤子都脱了，你给我看这个 The fog of war 战争迷雾 It is a picture Mr. Plucky paintsOf the complete failure of the key decision makers to get inside the minds of their counterparts, that is most telling. 但最能说明问题的是呢，是 Plucky 先生呢非常详细的描述了一个画面，就是说他们双方美苏的这个决策者呢都无法理解对方脑袋里在想什么。Khrushchev had convinced himself that Kennedy was a callow patsy who would back down when push came to shove. 赫鲁晓夫呢？非常看不起肯尼迪，他觉得肯尼迪呢是一个顽固的低矮的小个子嘛，是不是被施加了压力呢，他就不得不去 back down， 就是不得不退缩了。 When push came to shove 的意思就是说，因为你被逼到了某一种情况，你就不得不做一件事情。这里是说肯尼迪如果被赫鲁晓夫施加压力，赫鲁晓夫认为他就肯尼迪就会退缩是吧，最后就不得不退缩。 He reckoned that Kennedy would see there was an equivalence between the Jupiter nuclear missiles America had based in Italyand Turkey a few years before and the missiles the Soviets were sending to Cuba. 那赫鲁晓夫认为呢，肯尼迪应该知道，就是美国人在意大利和土耳其部署的这个木星核导弹呢，跟苏联呢目前送往古巴的这个核导弹，这些核导弹它的这个威慑力应该是同等，是相同程度的 equivalence 是吧。所以呢，美国赫鲁晓夫就认为呢，美国肯定不会轻举妄动。Khrushchev failed to understand that facing congressional elections in November, Kennedy would have been indulging in political suicide to have shown such weakness. 但赫鲁晓夫呢没有想到的是，因为面临呢国会十一月份这国会大选，如果肯尼迪发出这样一个弱势的信号呢，那么他就会被直接就是进入那种政治自杀 political suicide， 被陷入政治自杀里面去，所以肯尼迪肯定不会去示弱，对吧？所以呢，当时赫鲁晓夫对肯尼迪的这种决心啊，和他面临的这种处境是不了解，是有错误估计的。他觉得肯尼迪当时会退缩，但实际上肯尼迪可能真的不会。For his part, Kennedy was bamboozled by Khrushchev into thinking that a confrontation over Berlin was much more likely than over Cuba, which he believed the Kremlin understood to be in America's backyard and thus off limits. 但是在肯尼迪这方看来呢，肯尼迪呢就是被赫鲁晓夫欺骗了。肯尼迪就认为在柏林发生冲突呢，比在古巴发生冲突其实更加可能。为什么呢？是因为肯尼迪相信呢，赫鲁晓夫应该知道，古巴呢是美国的后院是吧 ？America's backyard， 所以呢是 off limits， 就是说它是一个红线 ，off limits 是不能逾越的红线。就是说，肯尼迪认为呢，赫鲁晓夫不会蠢到来。我们美国的后院也就是古巴搞事情是吧，谁知道那赫鲁晓夫就是这么个愣头青呢。 Even when Khrushchev's reckless gambit was blatantly revealed to Kennedy, faulty intelligence suggested that the Soviet force on the island was a quarter of its actual size. 那即使是后面呢，那即使当赫鲁晓夫这种不计后果的这种策略 reckless gambit was blatantly revealed to Kennedy， 就是在后面被接入给肯尼迪呢，那美国方面错误的情报也显示呢，苏联方面的军事力量呢，实际上只有他实际上的四分之一。就是说，当时美国的情报人员对这个苏联的实际上在美国部署的军事力量有一个误判，实际上苏联的这个实际军事存在呢，是美国当时情报估计的这个四倍。所以说，如果战争打起来，就是可能大家都对双方的实力会有一个比较震惊，是吧？Not until very late in the day, October 20th, that the president learned some of the missiles were operational. 直到十月二十日这一天呢，这天非常晚的时候呢，肯尼迪总统呢才知道有一些苏联送到古巴的导弹呢已经，能够开始马上就开始发射，进入发射状态了。战争也就是说一触即发。Until then, Kennedy had kept open the option of a full-scale invasion of the island, a course of action his military chiefs strongly favored.在此之前呢，肯尼迪一直公开宣称啊，就是仍然没有放弃全面入侵古巴的这种选项啊 ，kept open the option， 就是没有放弃这一选项。比如说我们说绝不放弃 武力统一台湾，我们可以说 kept open the option of liberating Taiwan by force。 他的军事长官呢，他军事首长肯尼迪的军事首长们，这是属于就是美国的军方一直都是鹰派啊，就强烈支持采取全面入侵的方式来解放古巴，不是，就是解决古巴危机。 One of Mr. Plucky's most unsettling revelations is the extent to which Soviet commanders on the ground had delegated authority, if attacked, to use tactical nukes that Washington knew nothing about until 30 years later. 那让 Plucky 就是这个书的作者最不安的一个发现就是呢，当时的苏联这种指挥官，地面指挥官实际上呢有 delegated authority，他实际上已经有授权就能够使用战术核武器啊！当时这些战术核武器呢，华盛顿呢就根本毫不知情，他们只有在30年之后才知情。 If Kennedy had listened to his generals, they would have been used. 那如果当时肯尼迪听了他的这些鹰派的美国将军们的话，去对古巴进行一个全面的侵略呢，这些战术核武器呢就会被使用。 Even if Kennedy and Khrushchev were both determined to avoid nuclear warThey were not in control of the events that could easily lead to it. 即使当时呢，肯尼迪和赫鲁晓夫都决定呢去避免核战争，但他们当时呢可能真的没有办法去掌控后面会发生的事情。That realization was the wake-up call that the two superpowers needed to create the protocols and communication channels required to avoid annihilation by misunderstanding in the future.意识到这一点呢，就给两个超级大国呢敲响了警钟。Was the wake up call？ 什么警钟呢？就是他们需要建立一个核武器方面的这个协调和沟通的一个机制和渠道，来去避免这种核战争导致的毁灭，由于错误的理解导致的核战争，然后导致的毁灭，就是未来需要避免这样一个事情。Khrushchev was ousted two years later, and in 1972, the first strategic arms limitation talks.Agreement was signed, paving the way for subsequent arms control agreements, all of which have been aimed at enhancing strategic stability. 赫鲁晓夫呢，在两年之后被下台，被罢免了。然后1972年呢，第一个战略核武器限制谈判就已经被签订了。这个协议的签订呢，为随后的军备控制协议呢铺平了道路 ，paved the way for something subsequent 随后的。Those arrangements have still left huge nuclear stockpiles on both sides, but the verification procedures they established helped build a degree of mutual trust that was a factor in ending the Cold War. So much so that today, existential dread about nuclear war has been largely replaced by anxiety about climate change and, more recently, pandemics. 他们建立这些核查程序呢，就是给双方留下了非常巨大的核武器的库存，这些核查程序呢，仍然有助于建立一个一定程度的相互信任，这是一个结束冷战的一个重要因素。人类对于核战争这种生存恐惧，我们现代人呢，已经被这种，气候变化和疫情啊，最近的疫情导致这种焦虑而取代了。其实我们更应该担心的是呢，可能真的是，一触即发的这种核战争的一个可能性，因为它会直接带来整个人类的毁灭。Such complacency.Is ill-founded. 这种自满呢是没有根据的。The era of arms control is unraveling. 军备控制的时代正在瓦解。Unraveling 就是瓦解。In 2019, the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty of 1987 collapsed after well-grounded American accusations of Russian cheating. 由于强有力的这种美国的这种对俄罗斯在这个核武器削减过程中的这种作弊行为，这种指控呢，导致1987年这种终极忠诚核力量条约已经崩溃，就是已经失去效用了 ，collapsed. This was a harbinger of worse to come. 那这预示着未来更糟糕的情况会发生，就是未来局势会继续恶化。Harbinger 就是一个预示、预兆。The New START Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty Agreement has been extended until 2026, but it will be difficult to replace it.新的削减战略核武器条约协议呢，已经延长到2026年，但是在这个条约到期，2026年到期之后呢，很难去用一个新的条约去取代它，继续去约束双方呢，去控制自己的核武器的使用和发展。Meanwhile, both Russia and America are renewing their nuclear arsenals at vast expense. While the deployment of new technologies such as cyber attacks on nuclear early warning satellites or a new breed of fast and accurate conventional missiles threaten both sides' retaliatory capabilities as well as their command and control apparatus. 同时呢，美俄双方呢都在付出巨大的代价来更新其核武库，而新技术的部署呢，例如在新的这种预警卫星上进行的网络攻击，或者新型的这种快速啊精确的常规导弹，对双方的这种核打击能力呢都带来了威胁，同时呢对他们这种指挥啊控制的这种系统也带来了威胁，也就是说这种核威胁呢实际上已经在慢慢的升级了，只是我们没有意识到而已。可能一般人都觉得古巴导弹危机的时候那个时候是最严重的，但实际上呢因为现在这个事情演化到现在，可能我们如今面临这种核威胁也不比当时小很多。With relations between the major nuclear powers more fraught than they have been for decades, there is growing potential for a dispute leading to a crisis, and a crisis leading to a war. 那随着主要核能国家之间的关系呢，比几十年来呢更加紧张，发生争端导致危机，再导致战争，这种爆发这种危机的这种可能性呢 ，growing potential 正在逐渐的增大。Meanwhile, other nuclear weapons states, China, Pakistan, India, and particularly North Korea, are expanding their nuclear forces. 同时呢，其他核武器国家，中国、巴基斯坦、印度等等，也在扩大其核力量。Iran's intentions remain a cause for concern. 伊朗的意图呢，也值得担心。In 1962, the world got lucky. 1920年呢，世界呢，比较幸运。But the lessons learned from that narrow escape nearly 60 years ago are in danger of being forgotten. 但是将近六十年前的这场危机，这场九死一生的危机当中学到了一些经验，正在逐渐的被忘记。With his masterly book, Mr. Plucky has sounded a warning bell. 通过他这本精湛的著作呢 ，Plucky 先生呢再次为我们敲响了警钟。